In this lecture, we will cover the Gauss law as relevant to the dielectrics, or we can say Gauss law for dielectrics. We'll also cover relative permittivity, which is basically nothing. You will see in the books, there is something called dielectric constant. That is the relative permittivity. You know that permittivity of vacuum is epsilon naught. If the permittivity of material is EM, then I can write E0 upon EM as relative permittivity, and this is written in the books as K, which is also called dielectric constant. I'll come to what dielectric actually does. I'm just introducing these basic things. And in case of Erodove, you will find K is written as E. So don't get confused with epsilon naught. It is still the relative permittivity. This is how Erodove mentions it. In fact, problems in Erodoves are very good as far as this dielectric problems are concerned. Now, we know the Gauss law. Gauss law is E dot ds is Q upon epsilon naught, and this is for the complete. So if you take a charge Q and you take a Gaussian surface, which is a sphere, you get the electric field at that point. Simply by applying this Gauss law. When this is basically when there is no dielectric, this is an absence of dielectric, and Q is actually the free charge. You will notice that in books you will find something called bound charge also, which is different from free charge. This is free charge. There is something called bound charge and bound charge density, and that is written as sigma b, and free charge density is written as sigma. Charge density is nothing but if you divide by the surface area. Now let us come to what how dielectric alters the notations in the Gauss law. We know in capacitor there is positive charge, negative charge, there are two plates. This is we treat as there is no dielectric here, so the epsilon naught is applicable here. The permittivity, we take epsilon naught for our convenience. Actually, it is for the vacuum. And if we take a Gaussian surface like this, you take a cylinder, Gaussian surface, and if you see the sides of cylinder, the electric field is running in between the plates, perpendicular to the plates, and here it will be parallel to the sides of the cylinder. So it is actually perpendicular to area vector. We need to be very clear about area vector. If you take a cylinder for the Gauss law purpose, be very clear that area vector here is written like this. And area vector here is written like this. This is the unit vector of area vector. Means it is perpendicular to the surface. It is perpendicular to the surface. So here, and this E dot ds, ds has to be along the area vector. This is important. So that is why we don't include the sides. And this we say, and here it becomes E dot ds. It becomes, what is the charge enclosed? Charge is sigma is the charge density. This is the free charge density. And area, we take this small area as ds. This is ds upon epsilon naught. And since electric field inside the conducting plate is zero, and the dot product on the side surfaces is zero. So if you take, there are three regions, one side and this. One has no electric field. In case of side, E dot ds is zero, so only one side is left, which is E into ds. This area is also ds, so it becomes E is equal to sigma upon epsilon naught. Is a simple case of the plates where there is no dielectric. Now, moment you put a dielectric, the situation changes, and you start having free charge and bound charge. That is what I want to explain. Now when you put, suppose these are the plates, which were initially having the charge plus sigma here, and this is minus sigma, the charge density. This is charge density plus sigma, and here it is minus sigma. These are conducting plates. Now I put a dielectric here. When I put a dielectric, there will be negative charge which will appear here, and the charge density of that is written as sigma bound, and it will be minus. Towards positive you will have negative charge, and positive charge is coming here. And how that comes? Actually, in dielectric what happens, you have these kind of polar molecules which align. There is positive charge, negative charge, positive charge, negative, negative charge, and they are initially not aligned like this. They are randomly aligned. In dielectric there are no free electrons. You have these kind of dipoles inside the dielectric, and all these dipoles are randomly organized in this dielectric. Moment you put electric field, what happens is the dipoles are aligned along the electric field. And I repeat, there are no free charges. Like in case of conductor, you have enough free charges to take care of the electric field. When you place a conductor in electric field, the positive and negative charge align in such a way that they make electric field inside the conductor as zero. But it doesn't happen in case of dielectric. The electric field in dielectric cannot be made zero because there are no free electrons to create an electric field which is equal and opposite to the electric field which is outside the conductor. Because the free electrons are enough, they keep on realigning, they keep on realigning. Supposing had there been conductor in this place, the free electrons would have gone on that side and positive charge would have been left on this side, and they will keep on going until they produce, if there is electric field E0 here before the conductor, they will produce E0 inside in such a way they will produce electric field because of the realignment, which is also equal to E0. This will nullify and you will have zero electric field inside the conductor. But that doesn't happen in case of dielectric. This is the difference we have to remember. In case of dielectric, we have dipoles, we don't have free electrons, we have bound electrons, and charges are there, positive, negative. They just realign and create the surface charges. They create surface charge density. I won't draw full. So, and little bit more space left. So you see, this is positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. This way they have aligned. And what has happened, if you look inside these regions, the charges are nullified because of positive, negative. So net charge inside the dielectric is also zero. The charge inside, excluding the surface, is net is zero because they are just cancelling each other, but the electric field is not zero. And what happens on the surface, you get this kind of a charge, and here you get sigma B positive, and here it is sigma. So the basic difference here you have to see is, one is the free charge, another is the bound charge. And free charge is sigma, bound charge is sigma B. Now when I apply the Gaussian surface in this situation, this is the plate, this is the dielectric, this is positive on the plate, which is sigma. I have taken a segment of it, and now I draw that same cylinder, and you had minus sigma B here, and you have sigma there. So the net charge enclosed is sigma minus sigma B now, and electric field here is zero. Here same, the area vector in electric field are perpendicular, so it is zero, zero. So you come down to only this surface, where here electric field, say it is E, and in absence of dielectric, it was E zero, now it is E. So E dot ds is equal to this into ds upon epsilon naught. Now it becomes, E becomes equal to sigma minus sigma B upon epsilon naught. So this is the electric field. You can see there are two parts. One is the part, had there been no dielectric, you would have got E0 is sigma upon epsilon naught. But in presence of dielectric, you got this. And we write this, the electric field you get inside the dielectric is written in terms of E is written as E0 upon K. Means electric field in absence of dielectric, electric field in presence of dielectric is written like this. So when I put this thing here, I get what is E0 is sigma upon epsilon naught K. So I just write it sigma upon epsilon naught K is equal to sigma upon epsilon naught minus sigma 0 sigma bound upon epsilon naught. Epsilon naught goes. So I get sigma 1 minus 1 upon K is sigma bound. So this is the most important part. My value of bound charge is sigma 1 minus 1 upon K. Now, when I write this equation, I write this equation here again. Now, E dot ds, I remove it. Now, E dot ds, with dielectric, I was writing as sigma minus sigma b into ds upon epsilon naught. Ds upon epsilon naught, I keep it like this. And I put sigma, value of sigma b, which is I write sigma minus sigma 1 minus 1 upon k. So I get it is basically same thing reworking out. I get sigma upon k ds epsilon naught is E dot ds. So what you have got is, this is what? This is the total free charge. This is the total free charge, sigma into ds. Sigma is the free charge. So I write it as q upon k into epsilon naught. So this is the form of the Gauss law when there is a dielectric. That's the only difference. This is how we write Gauss law when there is a dielectric. So if you have a problem where it is given that there is some charge, and outside that charge there is a region which has dielectric with dielectric constant as K, or it can be said relative permittivity as K, and here you have total charge as Q. So if you are asked to find what is the electric field in this region, like this, so simply apply the Gauss law for this surface. It's very simple, nothing great in it. Same thing, only thing is, now you will apply Gauss law for the dielectric. So E becomes E into 4 pi r square is equal to Q upon K epsilon naught. So electric field here is 4 pi epsilon r square into 1 upon k. So Gauss law in the form of Gauss law for